This is Fresh Air. I'm Terry Gross.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?
You probably know that song. It's the opening track from the 1963 album The Freewheelin Bob Dylan. If you're a Dylan fan, you also know the cover of the album, a photo of a young Dylan and his even younger girlfriend walking arm in arm down a Greenwich Village street. Lots of people have wondered about that woman's story. She tells it now in her new book, A Freewheelin Time. My guest is Suze Rotolo. She met Dylan when she was 17 and he was 20. They were a couple for about 4 years. She'd moved to Greenwich Village from Queens, New York, on her own after graduating high school. Dylan moved there soon after. At the time, the village was the center of the urban folk scene. Rotolo is an artist and teaches at the Parsons School of Design. She lives in Greenwich Village with her husband. Suze Rotolo, welcome to Fresh Air, and thanks for being here.
Thank you.
You met Dylan at a marathon folk concert at the Riverside Church in New York in 1961. He wasn't well known yet. He'd only recently arrived in Greenwich Village. You'd already been living there. What attracted you to him then? What did you know of him when you first started seeing him?
Well, there was a folk music club, Gertie's Folk City, in the village, and I used to go there, and he was performing with other people, or he'd play backup harmonica for other groups, and it was kind of the kind of place where other musicians played with other people, and then he gradually started playing with this one other folk singer, Mark Spolstra. And so I would see him around, and I enjoyed his harmonica playing. I thought he was really good in a funny kind of way. He'd sit in the back and really get into playing the harmonica. But we didn't actually talk to each other or see each other person to person until that folk concert at Riverside Church, where he was playing and by himself, and he was playing also with Jack Elliott, and that's when we kind of got to know each other.
In Dylan's biographical book, Chronicles, Volume 1, he writes about you in the end of the book, and I want to read some of the things he says about you. He says, "Right from the start, I couldn't take my eyes off her. She was the most erotic thing I'd ever seen. She was fair-skinned and golden-haired, full-blood Italian. The air was suddenly filled with banana leaves. We started talking, and my head started to spin. Cupid's arrow had whistled by my ears before, but this time it hit me in the heart, and the weight of it dragged me overboard. Susie was 17 years old, from the East Coast, had grown up in Queens, raised in a left-wing family. Her father had worked in a factory and had recently died. She was involved in the New York art scene, painted and made drawings for various publications, worked in graphic design and in off-Broadway theatrical productions, also worked on civil rights committees. She could do a lot of things. Meeting her was like stepping into the tales of 1001 Arabian Nights." And then he compares her to a Rodin sculpture come to life and says, "She reminded me of a libertine heroine. She was just my type." What? How does that description sound to you? Do you hear yourself in that description?
I think that's wonderful and generous and a lovely thing that he wrote. And he captured that sense of being young and meeting somebody and being overwhelmed by feelings for them. And that's what young love is. He did that well.
Talk about the cover, the now famous cover from the Freewheelin' Bob Dylan, the cover that you're on with him walking down a partially snow-covered street. He has his hands in his pockets and his shoulders up because it's cold. And you have your arms wrapped around one of his arms. You're wearing like a green trench coat that's tied around the waist. And you have nearly knee-high boots over your pants.
Mm-hmm.
And you look really in tune with each other. It's such a romantic cover. I mean, what woman didn't want to be on Dylan's arm in that cover? What woman didn't want to be in your place? So tell us how that cover came to be.
It was all very casual, and the apartment was very small, and the photographer came and the publicity guy from Columbia came. So then they figured they'd start taking some pictures in the apartment of Bob sitting around, pick up your guitar, put it down, sing something. And then Don Hunstein said to me, "Get in some of the pictures." So I did, and he took more pictures. And then he said, let's go outside and walk. It was very casual, completely unplanned. And it was freezing outside. And then again, referring to Bob getting dressed, he just took this thin suede jacket that wasn't good for a New York cold winter day. And I had on a couple of sweaters. The last one was his, a big bulky knit sweater, because the apartment was cold. And I threw on a coat on top. So I always look at that picture as I feel like an Italian sausage, because I had so many layers on. And he was freezing, and I was freezing and had more clothes on. It was very cold that day.
Well, he was freezing, you say, in part because he wore this light suede jacket, because it looked good.
Yes, image.
Even though he knew he was going to be really cold.
Yeah.
And who can blame him? It did look really good.
It looked good. He had impeccable taste. Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to sound harsh about this clothes thing, because who wouldn't want to look right on an album cover? It's like
exactly.
Really important. I think who wouldn't want to choose the right article of clothing and risk being cold.
Yes, it's true. Suffer for beauty, isn't it?
How did that album cover change your life?
I had no idea, and I don't think anyone who had anything to do with it thought it would have such an enormous impact. So it became something that was, you know, it was my identifier, but it wasn't my identity. So it became something that was separate from who I knew myself to be, which might sound odd, but I thought it was a great cover, a very unusual cover for the time. And the first time I saw it was, he was playing at Carnegie Hall, I think, or Town Hall, and the cover was blown up and put on right outside. It was in black and white and blown up very big. And that really made an impression. It was almost embarrassing. There we were up on 57th Street. Huge, huge. So each time the album began more and more known, as the album became more what it is, it became an iconic album, the more I could detach from it and just look at it. Okay, that's what that is. But it was an odd feeling for many years.
People still recognize you from the Freewheelin album.
I look exactly the same, Terry.
Yeah, don't we all?
Yes.
But, you know, still, it doesn't mean you're not recognizable.
Well, for those who notice those things, yes. I mean, otherwise, no. I mean, it's a funny kind of recognition. I mean, it's people who are Dylan files, you know, Dylanophiles, or however I could say that, would know to recognize the name, but not everybody does. So it's kind of a funny, sometimes I'm surprised that someone recognizes me, and, you know, most of the time nobody does. This is going to change that a bit, I suppose.
Well, I want to thank you so much for talking with us. Good luck with your memoir.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to speak to you.
Suze Rotolo's new memoir is called A Freewheelin Time, A Memoir of Greenwich Village in the 60s. We'll close with another song from the Freewheelin' Bob Dylan, whose album cover is a photo of Dylan and Rotolo. You can download podcasts of our show on our website, freshair.npr.org. Fresh Air's executive producer is Danny Miller. Our engineer is Bob Purdick. Dorothy Farabee is our administrative assistant. Roberta Shorrock directs the show. I'm Terry Gross.